Hi, my name is Jay Michaels, and some of you may recognize my voice from radio stations across Canada. Today, however, I am here as Jay Dudelay, the father of a son with Tourette's syndrome. I'd like to introduce you to three families, including my own, and we're going to share some personal experiences with you. Tourette's syndrome affects every family and every individual differently, so you might find that our experiences vary from yours. I have found that sharing is part of understanding, so join us as we share some of our stories. This is the Gooding family. Nadine has found a community in the Tourette Syndrome Foundation of Canada that understands her family. Her sons, Jacob and Chris, who have Tourette Syndrome and a full package of associated disorders, and her daughter, Charlotte, who shares some of the characteristics of her brothers. This is the Call family. We've become good friends with Brooke and Doug and their two sons, Ian and Matthew. Both boys have Tourette Syndrome and have found a great outlet in sports. And this is my family, my wife, Sherry, and I have two sons, Ashton and Dustin. Dustin is the one who has been diagnosed with Tourette syndrome, and that's where we start.
My son started seeing doctors, therapists, behavioral specialists, psychologists at 2. They tried him on an experimental dose of Ritalin at 3. He's being thrown out of daycare, but school's challenging us to put him in private school, to homeschool him. So I would have liked to have got the diagnosis 5 years previous. There's a lot of guilt afterwards.
I mean, after the diagnosis for Matthew, I mean, I just felt terrible because I started to relive in my mind every single time I said something to him. You know, you're really irritating me with that right now. I can't help it, Dad. Yes, you can. It's got to be 1,000 times without exaggeration that I've relived those moments as a father to say, man, did I ever screw up.
I'd say that all my family members reacted differently. My mom, when she found out that, you know, both my brothers were diagnosed, I think she did a lot to try and help them and get involved with the Tourette Syndrome Foundation. And my brothers, I think it made them closer together. My father, I think he didn't want to accept it, and he really didn't do much to deal with it.
So at first I was skeptical. My dad was skeptical. He didn't really want to believe it, or he didn't really believe it at first until there was a lot of proof. Like, for me and my dad, I guess it's because we're men, seeing is believing, whereas a mother has a more intuitive feeling inside of her where she knows that there's something wrong with her baby and she wants to do everything in her power to fix it. Whereas me and my dad were just like, well, no, just tell him to stop and he'll stop. And if he doesn't stop, that just means he's a bad kid.
Well, my husband was in complete denial.
So was mine. I think it had to do with the fact that I was home a lot and with the children and doing their activities and talking to teachers and all their friends. And what I saw were two very happy boys doing well in school, lots of friends. I just remember my husband more concerned and frustrated for all the future and, you know, what's the first thing people see when you walk into a business meeting or hear? It's your speech, it's your demeanor, it's your appearance. But I think that it, over time, my husband has, yes, he's definitely accepted now. This is the hand we're dealt, and he's going on the other side with helping with fundraising and promoting and that kind of thing. So he's turned a huge corner. But we would argue about that, you know, for a man who's always said the glass was half full, for a while he was thinking it was half empty.
When you talk about moving through the different stages of denial, I mean, who has time for that right now? Because these kids are growing and living and doing stuff, and I don't want to miss anything because I'm, you know, languishing in pity for my family. My kids aren't languishing in self-pity.
If you're going to allow yourself to get sort of caught up in the vortex of the guilt and of the anger, you're doing yourself a disservice, you're doing your family a disservice, most of all, you're doing your kid a disservice. Every day is a blank slate. Just, you know, congratulate yourself on the small victories. And for the failures, you just move on.
You kind of get a false sense of security, like, oh, everything's going along great. And then, boom, another day, things are changing and it all comes back to reality. I might be a little bit more stressed. But that's, I find, where my husband will try and calm me down. And we try and go back and forth that way.
Jay refers to it as waiting for the other shoe to drop.
Yeah.
Because when everything's going great, it's just so fabulous.
Isn't it easy to just say, oh, okay, well,
so this is what this normal is.
Yeah, and we're just going to go along and it's going to continue like this.
Right.
I remember in grade 6, being really frustrated with my tics because I couldn't concentrate and I was constantly doing my facial tics that I did at that time and I just couldn't focus.
He was going into junior high and that sort of gave it a whole new area of issues. He went from a school that went from JK to 6, where he knew almost everybody, into almost like a melting pot of kids bussed in from all over, and then that's sort of where our problems started.
Generally, they didn't understand, and they didn't want to understand, and it was tough. It was really tough.
I look back now, when we were going through it, I didn't think I was gonna make it. You know, there's those days that you wonder how you'll get through it, and you do, and I look back on it, and it seems distant somehow. I guess when you're going through the moment, it seems a little bit more intense, but, you know, now I look back at it and say, well, it really wasn't that bad, yet I know that there were moments when it really was awful, when it was bad.
My brother, he does different tics each and every day, and it just mixes and matches from day to day, and one might be stronger one day, and one might be weaker another day. And I mean, if he's getting stressful, then his tics get a lot worse. He begins to blink faster, he can't formulate sentences as well, he's not as articulate.
And of course, when you're ticking that much and you've got yourself that exhausted by the end of the day, you certainly don't have any focus for your schoolwork. He's not deliberately not paying attention. I think he does want to learn. And I think Dustin feels sometimes misunderstood because he does care and he does want to do well. And he comes home and tells us that.
What's really interesting with our boys, we find, is as Ian's tics wax, Matthew's wane. And then Matthew's tics wax, and then Ian's wane. It's almost as if they're giving and taking to each other. They always have some, but for some reason, one is stronger than the other.
And they have the freedom perhaps another family might not have, and the fact that they can just tick along, do their own thing in complete understanding of each other. And so, you know what, you know, if you've got one with TS, make it a party. We've got two, it's working pretty good for us.
My favorite is, are you sure he has that? Because he's been focusing really well today. Well, when you're doing something you like, when you either have ADHD or Tourette, you focus. It's been proven that when a kid with TS, when they're focused on something that they like, they don't tick as much. So if you're playing a video game, you won't be ticking. It's just
as much.
You mm-hmm. It won't stop. But the teachers, I just want teachers to know that.
There can be times where Matthew can be inflexible, and I believe that is part of his Tourette syndrome. We're all human, and there are days where you just don't want to deal with inflexibility, but we do, and it's there, and it's part of him. But I'm finding as he's getting older, we're able to work through things.
And I think we're moving absolutely in the right direction, but it's taken a lot of hard work, and it takes the recognition that he's into something right now and he can't see out of, so we can't expect him to see out of it. We gotta stop. We gotta try to reframe, refocus,
redirect.
And redirect.
If I'm doing a project, I can't work. I have to, every like 10 minutes, I have to walk around the house, take a bath, in the middle of it.
He says, I'm going to take a bath, a hot bath. And that's something Matthew has discovered on his own and he takes full control of. And sometimes he has two hot baths in a day. And if that's gonna help him, then
that's
his strategy and it's awesome.
We need a hot tub. That's a strategy.
Yeah.
And a big screen TV.
Well, the yelling doesn't work.
No, yelling not an effective strategy.
No.
It tires yourself out, but it doesn't really help with your child. Really, I don't know what the strategy we have for getting him to, helping him to go to sleep. It's just a wind down process, mm-hmm. really.
We've now told him, you know what, at bedtime you can read for an hour. As long as you can pick an activity that you can do in bed that's not going to keep everyone else in the house awake. But he has a terrible time falling asleep. And sometimes we'll come into our room 12 times after he's been put to bed. I just have one more thought. I just have one more thought. I just need to do one more thing.
Just thoughts, like, just things like, wow, I wonder what the color of the rainbow is, or anything I can think of. Any thought that goes in my head, it keeps me awake. My head's right about to fall asleep, and then a new thought pops in my head, and then that's another hour onto my going to bed.
Usually a thought of, oh goodness, I have to do this tomorrow, or I didn't do this today, so I've got to get out of bed right now and do it. and he has to get out of bed and do the whole routine all over again. And so it's disruptive.
It's really hard to fall asleep, so I'll read books and I'll play guitar, my electric one, so it's not noisy without the amp. And I'll do anything I can. I'll play with Lego, I'll play with anything I can find. I'll talk to my pillows, anything that will make me fall asleep.
You know, Brooke and I are two very different people in terms of how we approach anything. I am a person that requires plans and action, and Brooke has a more laissez-faire style and approach to things. When it comes to how we approach Tourette, then it's a little different, because then we're talking about things like medication, and that does at times put us at odds about what is the best course of action. Are we being responsible to our children in terms of having them be as successful as they can be with Tourette?
We didn't get pressure from the teachers to put Dustin on medication. We got pressure. We can't control him. We can't control him. And they never came right out and said, put him on medication. But they kept saying things like, something has to be done. Something has to be done, or he can't be here. Well, what do you mean he can't be here? It's school.
I work in school, and it's very difficult. You can't tell somebody you need medication, and I can't even recommend a kind. But what you can say, and what the schools do say, is, you know, something needs to be done.
It's a fine line. When Chris was diagnosed, he was 12, which made him older, and that makes it like 12 years ago. And I wanted the magic pill. So unfortunately, the doctor we found tried the old medications. The side effects were huge. And after about 2 years, Chris wouldn't take anything.
When you decide to give your child medication, then it's how much? Mm-hmm. And let's take him off this and change this and switch this. And you feel like you're...
And what are those possible side effects?
Yeah. Am I making my child a guinea pig here? What are the long-term effects? And what are the short-term effects?
And so often you hear parents, they start talking about, you know, well, what my kid's on this and this dose. We found with Chris, we were doing 0.25 milligrams of a tablet at a time to go up to a dose. You know, kids were on 4 times the amount of dose that he was on. Didn't work. So all the, you know, every time there's this talk of, well, how much are they on and what are they on and does this work and does that work? And it's so individualistic, you can't really even begin to talk about it.
No.
And every child's different, because both of my boys are on the same medication. My eldest son is actually on more in terms of a daily dosage, but the younger one is putting on the weight.
Mm-hmm. My son was just pulling his hair out, and he just said, I'm damned if I do, and I'm damned if I don't. He said, if I don't take this medication, I'm going to tick. And he swings his head around, and he blinks, and the kids make fun of him. Mm-hmm. And if he takes the medication, he gains weight. So now the kids are making fun of him, and he doesn't want to go to pool.
I mean, that's so true.
So he's at a point now where he doesn't know what to do.
Yeah, marriages take a different turn anywhere. I mean, anytime I think anybody deals with any particular challenges. But the TS, I think, has certainly put a bit of a... It's accentuated some of our differences because of the seriousness of the decisions that at times you're required to make. Medication, for example, and what my expectation is out of the medication versus Brooke's. Different risk tolerances. I'm willing to take higher risks, and I think that's just me, versus what Brooke is willing to take. The men want the immediate gratification. We want the fix. And at times, you know, Brooke doesn't want the risk. So that's a balance that we have to find. Some days we find it, other days we don't. You know, but then we haven't agreed on wallpaper either, so.
When you watch your kid in the throes of ticking, it's like they're just trapped in this box, like they're in a little prison that they just can't, and they absolutely have no control whatsoever of it. And then, you know, and then he's fine for a while. And, you know, I lay his pills out through the day, and I just look at the sheer amount of drugs that I have to put in my child's system and have him drugged 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, just so he can function. Because without it, it's terrible. So, yeah, there's been some nights where you just break down and you just sob, you know, because it's your kid and you can't fix it, you know?
You can't fix it.
You can't fix it.
You have a limited knowledge of what Tourette syndrome was. So when Brooke came home from the pediatrician and she said, you know, the pediatrician would suggest that TS is a possible option,
I mean, I really didn't know what that was. I didn't really understand where it was taking us as a family. I mean, ignorance is bliss.
I think that's where the denial comes in, is originally, if he can't fix it, he doesn't want it to be going on. So he wants to pretend that it's not there.
I just have a hard time trusting people in power situations, I guess, because from my experiences, they tend to abuse that power, and you lose trust, a lot of trust in people, teachers, police.
I gave him an out, and your out is you walk away. And it doesn't matter, I think grade 8, I gave him a quarter and said, you've always got a quarter in your pocket. If things get really, really bad at school, you walk out, you go to the payphone, here's the payphone, call me and I'll come and get you, we'll straighten this out. So that was his coping mechanism, was if things got too hairy, he could walk.
I remember getting off the bus and walking in the door, and my mom would say, how was your day? And I just throw a fit. I didn't want to even look at my mom even. Because I had such a bad day, and just throw my backpack and start cursing and swearing or whatever I do.
Here's this mini tornado who's just come in, and we're ducking from the backpack and the shoes and the stomping up the stairs, and then you have the other brother running after him saying, well, you know, what's the matter? Let's go out and play. Do you want to play soccer?
I just felt so tense and angry and frustrated that nothing was going right, and I just needed my alone time.
My husband sat me down and he said to me, he said, okay, our son is having rage attacks in the morning. He's lashing out at you. He was really scared he would hurt me. And my older son at the time was 14, 15, and he was holding his little brother down till he calmed down in the morning. And that was our strategy, was to hold him down until he stopped.
Sometimes that's really hard. You do the whole peacekeeper role, and it's very tiring.
I wanted to enjoy all the things about my son that are good and wonderful, because there's so many things. And now I try to advocate to all kinds of people how great he is, but I can understand what they're seeing because I saw that side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll move him over so I don't have one too close to you.
I find that I get so hyper and so excited about when I'm playing a sport that I get too competitive, not competitive, like really competitive. Like if I lose, it's the end of the world. Like I would do anything to win.
I call it ultra competitiveness. I've said that about my own son in particular, and I think a lot of parents would probably agree that their kids are the world's greatest winners. But when it comes to losing, you know, it's always everybody else's fault. It was the ref's fault. It was my stick sucks. It was always an excuse. And one of the things we've had to do with Dustin is literally, we'd have to remove him from the game. That would just be it. And just say, you know, you can't play like this.
It's actually a good lesson to be on a team.
Then you realize that it's not you, you're not the winner out there. You need these people. So it's just like being part of this family. We all need it to rally together to work on these things with TS. And we did. So we're winning, right?
Yeah. Right now I snowboard and I play basketball and lacrosse. TS doesn't affect it basically at all, because you're having fun doing something and you're focused on it. Sports is like the cure basically to me.
For a kid with TS and associated disorders, it really gives you a chance to just be like everybody else. Because regardless of, you know, how much twitching you do at the plate or under your helmet or under your gear, if you make the shot or a good pass or a goal, you're just like everybody else. So really it's a great equalizer.
We're fortunate that we do have two terrific kids, and they're both very, very athletic in sports. Ian's had a lot of success from a baseball perspective, probably playing at the highest level. And Ian was a pitching. He'd been brought in a very tight situation in the game, and of course, and he had a bit of a head shake at that point in time. So he's kind of doing the old, you know, head moving like this. And this woman sitting beside Brooke turned to her and said, oh, look, you know, he's shaking off the catcher signs, which is just hilarious.
Because at this level, they don't do signs.
Because it made him look like a real professional pitcher up there.
Exactly.
And, yeah, and I just like to go on the record to say he did get us out of the inning. No runs. That's my boy.
If I'm pitching, right, everyone's watching me.
Right.
I just have to focus, because usually when I'm focused, I won't do my ticks. Like, if I'm in the middle of a pitch, I won't tick.
Yeah.
So I just have to stay focused and usually it will go away.
What I tended to do with Dustin was I wouldn't tell his coaches about his disorder. And hopefully then he would make a team on his own accord, and then I'd sort of, which is probably not the proper thing to do, I'd deal with it after the fact and say, well, now that you've got him, here's the situation. But he tried out for a lacrosse team. First night went fantastic. The next day he punched the coach's son in the face. So I talked to the coach that night and I said, you know what, oddly enough, I haven't really shared this with you, but my son has Tourette's syndrome and he can lash out sometimes, and given the situation, I really, you know, obviously I apologize on his behalf. And the coach said, wow, I wish I hadn't known that. I play professional lacrosse with a guy that has Tourette's syndrome. Had I have known that going in, and I made that decision that day that, you know what, I really am doing my kid a disservice by not giving the coach all of the information going in, because generally coaches are there because they want to be there.
I think you want to be fair to other people and say, if you speak with the glass half full, you say that people are understanding and flexible and inclusive. But then at times we all know that that's just not the way things are. Are there opportunities where we think perhaps Ian might have been, well, I'll use the terminology, quietly discriminated against? I can speculate, can't prove it. And obviously we move past it because most coaches that we've had to deal with have been very accommodating, aware, interested, inquisitive, and we've been fortunate for that because we know that that's not the case all the time.
So are you playing on Thursday?
And I actually have sort of learned a few things from my own son about patience and about understanding and about tolerance of other people. It's really helped the idiot factor drop a bit for me.
I actually think that when you're a member of a team, they're more more protective of Dustin because he has Tietz. If anybody on another team makes fun of him, or if they go anywhere together, like a restaurant in between games, and they notice anyone staring, there's some type of camaraderie. You can't make fun of somebody on my team. And so they protect him. It's like a, I don't know, it's
a bubble.
Pretty good.
I guess that's why we're all sitting here as a family, because if you're not willing to cope or you can't just cope that day, then you can hand off. Big brothers are good for taking little brothers out for hot chocolate. And dads are great for taking them out to throw the ball around.
When Dustin was a little bit younger, the school used to call me and they'd say that we think Dustin's had enough for today. And I would literally go pick him up at lunch and he'd just take the afternoon off and we would just go have lunch or shoot pool. Or just go home and watch a movie, like literally play hooky, just because the school couldn't handle it anymore.
And I don't know how you feel about this, but you have two boys with TS, and one of my problems my husband and I discuss very often is, what about the other one?
I know what you mean, and it is good to do things for both parents to switch off and do things with each child alone as well. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes, in our case, one child may get more attention because of his sports. I think we also need time as couples. I have a friend with three children. Middle son has TS plus. She's been through a lot. And their biggest advice is you need to get away. You and your husband need time alone. I firmly believe that, whether it's a night out or a weekend or a week, although it'd be lovely to have.
Well, every couple needs it, not just families.
Everybody does.
I look at myself and think, you know, my oldest is out of the house now, my middle one is getting there, you know, another year and a half, Charlotte will be off in college, and I just sort of have always sort of pushed the envelope out, you know, well, in another year, in another year, maybe next year, maybe next year, and...
Yeah, I know, next it never comes.
Yeah, it doesn't.
I think for me, it's fear. You've spent so much time focusing on getting your kids on track and advocating for them that you forget how to advocate for yourself and what you need.
And your self-worth sometimes goes down, that you just think, well, you know, well, what can I do? I'm just a mom, you know, and yeah, I'm a good mom, but, you know, sometimes you can't put that on a resume. I'm a really good mom. Please hire me.
Where work is rewarding and you can do a project and finish the project and you have an end result, with TS, it's something that we know we have to do forever and ever, and you don't see the results all the time. So... It's completely different.
It's important to have a support system for us, just to be able to talk to other parents, like to meet Doug, to have our kids play together. And for the kids especially, they see each other and they're just like, you have what I have. And then, boom, all the normal getting to know you stuff that they have with quote-unquote normal kids, it's gone.
I find myself at times listening to family friends of ours talk about their, you know, challenges with their kids. And even though I know that they, within their spectrum, consider them to be extremely serious. I mean, I look at what Jay and I might be addressing on a daily basis, and I just think that we are on a, you know, we're flying fighter jets and they're flying commercial airplanes. I mean,
we're super dads.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I really do have a tremendous amount of respect. You know, as soon as I meet a TS dad, I just know.
With my son's condition, I've literally had to change the way I treat him completely different than my other son. For instance, a set of directions I give my older son, I have to break down to the most minute of details for my younger son, because taking the recycle boxes out and coming back inside takes on a whole new meaning when you have TS and associated syndromes or disorders. Your set of expectations becomes completely different, whereas you expected so much. I'm not concerned about my son being a valedictorian or excelling. I'm concerned about him surviving.
Yeah,
it's literally that simple.
Somebody once asked me, what do you want for your children? I said, at this stage, I just want them to get into the same trouble that everybody else gets into, that they have the same chances to make mistakes, that they have the same chance to be turned down by a girl at the dance, that they get into the same trouble that I got into with my friends. Because if they do that, then I actually consider that successful. I try not to speak in absolutes anymore. If you've got TS, a 50% chance of having children with TS, I don't speak in terms of my kids having kids, because they might choose not to, having lived this life. So I don't convince myself, perhaps, that I'll be a grandfather.
I absolutely want my son to have kids just so I can spoil them and get back at him. You know, and that karma's got to go full circle.
If we keep teaching our children to advocate for themselves, then that's going to make a better world for them. It's going to be easier for them. There's going to be people out there that are still not going to understand, and will never, and they'll never understand any exceptionality, because that's the type of people that they are. And that's the other thing we have to teach our kids. That one person is going to bother you, bother anybody, whether they're short, tall, large, thin, whatever. Yeah. So
I can consistently tell my boys it's mind over matter. You don't mind and they don't matter.
I think in terms of success, I think we're doing very well as a family. Chris has moved out. He has his own apartment. He has his own job. He's working full time.
I guess just getting out in the work world, it's a lot more free, and it took a lot more of the pressure off, and I could just do the best I could do at my job. And it's been fine so far. So
I think by and large, we've weathered the storms, we're stronger for it, and we're doing okay.
We've became really close because we're fighting a battle together. We're fighting to advocate for these people, for people to realize that they're just normal kids.
They just want what everybody else wants. And I've got to agree, I think my kids and I are really, really close. And I don't know if we would have been that close without the TS diagnosis or not.
We will never know.
No.
But and like I said before, with my two boys going through the same thing, has made them really close. And we too have friends tell us, you know what? Those boys' personalities are going to get them through everything.
They're going to have a skill that so many kids today don't have, that strength, if things are going really bad or if something really tragic happens. They're going to deal with it completely differently.
They're also going to be more accepting of others.
Right.
You hope. They're going to be more accepting of others with exceptionalities.
Very
more
empathetic
sensitive
people.
And exactly. So we are, I think, helping our children to be,
tick together?
Good citizens.
Yeah, good citizens, good people of the world, leaders. They're the leaders of tomorrow.
Right.
I had a friend of mine who said to me recently how he's really concerned for a son. And I said, what do you mean? He says, well, take Ian, for example. He says he's growing up with TS. He's tackling it head on. He's doing everything you could want a son to do from the perspective of their father. My kid's just drifting through life. He has no challenges in front of him. And he goes, and I worry about where that's going to take him. But I think it's an interesting comment for somebody to make, that they're concerned about their child because there's nothing in front of them challenging them, nothing thinking about how they're going to react to life, nothing preparing them for this world that they're going to enter into.
If Tourette's syndrome could come with a specific handbook, I think the number one rule would be don't try and do this alone. And my heart goes out to any single parent that's trying to deal with this, because just to have someone to talk to counterbalance you, to help reinforce the strategies, to be a cheerleader as you deal with this, because it's just, It really is 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, you deal with the TS. And it's just, it becomes such a huge priority in your life that to try and do it alone, I couldn't imagine, I can't even fathom going it alone.
Our job is to find all the things, all the strategies, all the coping mechanisms, all the support that we can get so that we can get him through his day and so that we can have a life together as a family.
We all accept it. And I mean, everybody's born with strengths and weaknesses, and I see Dustin's Tourette as a strength.
Focus on what the kids are doing and how they're being successful and making friends.
I think there are kids that look to our kids to say they are leaders in what they do.
I've gone through the whole gamut of those emotions, of the denial and the anger and the frustration and the sorrow and all that. And I think I'm pretty accepting, and you know, it's just part of our lives.
I think as far as acceptance and understanding goes with Tourette syndrome, we've completely 100% accepted it.
I always have this vision that in, you know, 20 years from now, I can see us still being really strong, mm-hmm. and very close, because we've had to overcome something in the fact that we're together, that we were able to accomplish that. So I don't think there's anything that we couldn't do now.
Everybody needs to be on board and everybody needs to be supportive, or else you all lose. If one of us didn't want to be involved with Dustin, or wasn't willing to make the accommodations or do those extra things that families are supposed to do for each other, you've lost before it's even started. So if we could say anything to families, it would be, you gotta all stick together.
And I mean, just look at it this way, it could always be worse.
That's right. You could be in our family.